Let us now look through some of these structures of the head. We see here on this side that the nasal septum is still intact. We're going to go ahead and we're going to remove that. The nasal septum being cartilaginous. We can see very nicely right here, there's the opening of the nasal lacrimal duct. Okay. We can see here the dorsal nasal meatus and then the dorsal nasal turbinates. And here's the ventral nasal turbinates down here with the middle nasal meatus and then the ventral nasal meatus down below here. Let's come back over to this side. See once again the dorsal nasal meatus. The dorsal turbinate has been cut here, ventral nasal turbinates, and then the ventral nasal meatus here. You can't see it so well on this one, but over on this one you can see very nicely the ethmoidal turbinates. Notice they're a little bit different in color than the nasal turbinates. Okay, remember the ethmoidal turbinates are important because this is where the olfactory epithelium is at. This space here between the turbinates and the septum was the common nasal meatus. So if we pass a nasogastric tube, we generally pass it at the junction of the common nasal meatus with the ventral nasal meatus. It'll pass through here. Here we have the quinae, which is the end of the nasal cavity going into the nasopharynx. Let's come back over to this side. We can see that nasopharynx nicely. Let's cut this here. In our nasopharynx right here, we have the opening of the auditory tube, which goes to the middle ear, allows for equalization of pressure in the ear. Here we have this fold here is the palatopharyngeal arch, and that is one end of the nasopharynx, and this here at the quinae is the other end, so that's the nasopharynx. Down here we have a fold of tissue which is the palatoglossal arch, so this is the beginning of our oral pharynx. And then this region around the larynx up to this ridge is the laryngeal pharynx, this ridge being the pharyngeal esophageal lumen, and then caudal to that we have the esophagus. Okay, now we look here in the oral pharynx, we've got a fold of tissue known as semilunar fold, which sits over the palatine tonsil. Okay, let's see, what else do we have in here? Here we have a little structure here. This is the sublingual caruncle. Upon this, the ducts of the, let's go to this side, the mandibular and the monostomatic sublingual salivary glands empty upon. Okay. And we will see here more glandular tissue. This in here is the polystomatic sublingual salivary gland. And as its name implies, it's going to have multiple openings into the oral cavity. Okay. Let's come back over to this one. So here we have the larynx that's been cut. Okay, so we have the epiglottic cartilage here. We have the thyroid cartilage here. The thyroid cartilage we then see coming up back over here. The arytenoid cartilage is kind of shaped like this. This is the corniculate process. This kind of funky shaped process here, kind of shaped like ancient cuneiform writing from Mesopotamia. That's the cuneiform process. Then we have the vocal process on which the vocal fold attaches. And then we have out here the muscular process upon which many of our muscles are going to attach. Okay, so here's our vocal fold. This is the ventricle of the larynx. And then over here is our vestibular fold. And then over here we have the cricoid cartilage. Okay. We look up here, we see a muscle whose fibers are going this way. And it's on the top of the cricoid cartilage. This is the cricoarytenoideus dorsalis. This is going to be responsible for opening the airway. Right down here is the cricoarytenoideus lateralis, which is going to be responsible for closing the airway. This muscle here coming off the thyroid cartilage up to that muscular process is going to be the thyroarytenoideus. This is going to be responsible for loosening the vocal fold and lowering the pitch. And down here is the cricothyroideus, which is going to be responsible for raising the pitch. Okay, let's turn this guy over this way. As we can see some nice muscles here. So this muscle here coming from the sternum, going up to the hyoid bones, that's going to be the sternohyoideus. And then we have here the sternothyroideus coming up to the thyroid cartilage. So here once again is that cricothyroideus, sternothyroideus, and this is going to be the thyrohyoideus. Okay. And this here is the thyropharyngeus, one of our pharyngeal muscles. That's a good landmark because entering here, just rostral to it, is going to be our cranial laryngeal nerve. Okay, we'll come back to that and talk about the nerves. Okay, let's look over in here. We see a muscle here that's coming from the stylohyoid bone going into the tongue, and it's also running right here within our palatoglossal arch, and that's going to be our styloglossus muscle. Okay. Here coming off the hyoid bones and going into the tongue, and we can see it doing that in here as well. From this side, that's going to be the hyoglossus muscle. Okay, so it's here and here. Okay. Now this very thin muscle on the outer surface here, this is going to be the myelohyoideus muscle. And here we find one going from the chin to the hyoids. The chin would be genio, so this is going to be the geniohyoideus. And this one coming from the chin going into the tongue is going to be the genioglossus. Okay, so now we've covered the hyoid muscles as well as the muscles of the tongue. So let's now review the actions of these muscles on the larynx. Okay, the cricoarytenoideus dorsalis muscle, notice its fibers are going this way to attach to the muscular process of the arytenoids. So if my hands are the arytenoid cartilages, the fibers are coming this way to attach out here. So when they contract, they're going to abduct the vocal folds, pull them out of the way of the airway, so it opens up the airway. The cricoarytenoideus lateralis, however, its fibers are coming up this way. So when it contracts, it's going to close the airway. We look here at the thyroarytenoideus. Okay, they're going to pull the arytenoid cartilage ventrally. Pulling it ventrally is going to loosen that vocal fold. It'll somewhat close the airway as well, but it loosens that vocal fold so our pitch goes down. Okay. Now the cricothyroid, it's going to have an action that's going to pull on these cartilages so that the thyroid cartilage tightens like this, or turns downward so that it tightens the vocal fold. It's going to also open the airway, but by tightening the vocal fold, it's going to increase the pitch. Okay? Okay, here we've cut away the temporalis muscle. Remember, the temporal line and the temporal fossa are named for the temporalis muscle. And we removed that so that we can see down in here the pterygoid muscles. Okay, so we can also see, if we dissect up in here, so now we can see here the pterygoid muscles from this side. And once again, this is our polystomatic sublingual salivary gland. And here are the ducts from the monostomatic sublingual salivary gland and the mandibular gland coming over to the sublingual caruncle. And here also is another muscle of mastication, which is the digastricus muscle. This is the only one that opens the mouth. And so we have our masseter muscle, our temporalis muscle, and our pterygoid muscles that are responsible for closing the mouth.